Man's conquest of the air has taken him 14 miles into the unknown reaches of the stratosphere. At this terrific height, ordinary hills appear as flat as a carefully tended lawn. Strange as it may seem, if the Earth were to grow smaller and smaller and smaller until it became the size of an apple, the thickness of a postage stamp would correspond to an altitude of 14 miles. An Earth the size of an apple would be as smooth as a polished steel ball. Mountains and valleys would be about gone. What a queer world it would be if we could polish the surface of our Earth to this perfect finish. As smooth as a lake on a calm day. And what a paradise for automobile drivers. On a world like this, there wouldn't be any need for tires or springs or upholstered cushion seats. There would be no jolts to disturb passengers, no discomfort from vibration, even in a car with solid steel wheels. But our Earth is not anything like this. Nature has carved the world's surface with wind and water and ice, and man can never polish it to smoothness. The early American Indians had to get under their bumps, and so they used springy grass mats to ease the jars on their heads. Even before the invention of the wheel, men discovered the idea of springs and began to use them to absorb bumps. Our world is covered with bumps. Bumps on roads are the public enemies of all who ride on wheels. When a wheel passes over a rough surface, you get a jolt. When the jolts come too close together, you get vibrations, which are usually unpleasant. The rate of vibration depends on how close together the bumps are and at what speed you hit them. When the rate of vibration is too slow, you are uncomfortable. And when the bumps come fast, it isn't any fun. Unless the rate is changed by knee action. The muscles of the legs act as springs, which help to absorb unpleasant jolts. As early as 1665, leather springs were used on coaches. When men began to travel faster on wheels, the rate of bump vibrations increased and better springs were needed. Then, the first elliptical steel spring was patented by Obadiah Elliott in 1804. In the meantime, another way to absorb vibration had been discovered, rubber. It was first used on carriage wheels in 1795. Pneumatic tires came in 1888, but were not in general use until the automobile became popular. Then in 1919, the hydraulic shock absorber was invented. It took care of the excessive bouncing of steel springs at higher speeds. When balloon tires were placed on the market in 1925, the driver began to think he rode pretty comfortably. But there was still one obstacle to a smooth ride: pitching. The front springs, besides springing the front end of the car, had to be stiff enough to hold the front axle steady for steering, and therefore, the front of the car moved up and down faster than the rear. This caused uncomfortable pitching due to lack of harmony or balance between the front and the rear springs. However, in 1934, engineers introduced a principle to relieve the front springs of every job except springing the front end of the car. The front springs could now be perfectly balanced with the rear. The greatest contribution to riding ease since the invention of the steel springs and the pneumatic tire. And thus, we ride today on upholstered seat cushions, on balloon tires, with carefully balanced springs controlled by shock absorbers. But in order to get a good standard of comparison between what we have and what we used to have, we'll substitute wooden boxes for the upholstered cushion seats, disconnect the shock absorbers, and make the balanced rear springs rigid with this wooden block. Then make the knee action useless by putting a steel cylinder in place of the spiral spring and put four solid steel wheels in place of the four balloon tires. By using riding lights in key positions and photographing them in the dark, engineers can discover exactly what kind of ride passengers are going to get. This car will give us an idea of what driving would be like without upholstered cushion seats, balloon tires, shock absorbers, balanced springs, and knee action. It is as solid and unyielding as the Rock of Gibraltar. Now we fasten a lamp to the rear window so that the ups and downs can be watched, a lamp on the radiator to see how the front end of the car behaves, and a lamp on the driver's shoulder. When the Yamariograph makes its accurate record, we see that the riding lights form a graph which shows the exact degree of the passenger's comfort. Let's arrange a specially built road to give the car a terrific jolting. With the Yamariograph, which is a scientific means of measuring riding comfort, slow motion photography shows the path of the ride lights as the car travels over the bumps. The wavy lines show the excessive pitching. Now, beginning with the tires, let's put back all of those things which absorb bumps and see how they affect the travel over this artificial road, which shows how they absorb bumps of all kinds. Let's put back the big upholstered spring seats. Let's restore the balanced rear springs. Let's reconnect the shock absorbers. And let's put back the knee action to balance perfectly with the rear springs. Now, when we use the Yamariograph, we can see that the complete modern automobile rides like this, smoothly, comfortably. Even in broad daylight, we can see the difference. Here, in slow motion, are two cars traveling over the same bad road. One has the old-style springing, the other has every comfort-producing feature. And so we have made the world smoother. And from now on, everybody that owns a modern motor car can take it easy.